Okay, we're broadcasting and we are live in Paisley on iMTV. Your host Rob Ellen here. Paisley, renowned for music, and we're going to go back into that in the company with Davey Pattison, who is one of Paisley's big, not forgotten, but you've been away from Paisley for so many years now, Davey. Yeah?
40 years, yeah.
40 years. I want to talk about your remarkable career and where we are in Davey's home. Oh, there are photos and memorabilia from that remarkable career behind us. So I want to talk.
Life is on the wall.
Your life, it's a wall of pain.
Yeah.
Wall of fame here with Davey. Davey, singer. A singer, basically, yeah.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah.
Yeah. And when you were growing up, you would have been, Jerry Rafferty would have been kicking around doing gigs, was he?
I'm not from Paisley.
Right, okay.
I lived in Paisley from 1970 until 1979.
Right.
When we went to America.
Uh-huh.
I'm from Glasgow, initially.
Okay. So let's talk about that process that got you to America. At the time you were just, you'd have been out and about just doing the...
Well,
local gigs in Glasgow.
Yeah, I was kind of doing what everybody else was doing, playing the pubs.
Everybody else being the likes of Alex Harvey and
Frankie
Miller and
I knew them all.
Yeah.
My last gig actually in Glasgow was pretty much, I was singing in the Locarno in Glasgow.
There you go.
For my friend Bill Patrick, who's a dear friend and still with us, thankfully. And at the weekends, we'd play Friday and Saturday in the Locarno. It was Tiffany's then, I guess. And I'd fly down to London.
Because everything had to happen through London in those days.
London was the place to be. I mean, if you weren't going to London, you weren't doing anything.
Yeah.
But I'd fly down there every week for a couple of days, and I'd work with a producer called Matthew Fisher, who was the organ player in Procol Harum.
There you go.
It was Jimmy Dewar,
yeah,
who was a dear departed friend, who turned me on to Matthew.
Yeah.
I was staying at Jimmy's house round the corner and recording at Matthew's studio in Croydon. That, in turn, got to the ears of Bill Graham in California, who called me up in the middle of the night.
Bill Graham?
Yeah.
Is a producer?
And he's a
label owner.
Promoter, management.
Yeah.
He managed, when I was there, he managed Gamma, Van Morrison, Bob Dylan,
yeah.
Carlos Santana.
Yeah. So that's the high table.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, I thought I'd die and go to heaven.
Yeah.
Who wouldn't?
Yeah.
You know. Actually, in many ways, I did go to him because we were playing the biggest gigs in America.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of stadiums, so, arenas.
So were you headhunted for a band over there, or was it...?
No, Bill was looking for a singer for Gamma.
For Gamma.
And they heard my stuff.
Yeah.
I think Jimmy and Bill Lorden, the drummer from Trower's band.
Yeah.
Those days.
So you were connected with Robin Trower?
Yeah, through Jimmy.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It's quite a story, actually.
That's a catalyst.
Yeah,
right there,
it really
right?
is.
Yeah.
We toured constantly in America, in Europe, all over the damn place, for months and months on end. That was how you did it in those days. You brought an album out, and you went out on the road to promote it.
Yeah.
Hopefully people would see your show and go to the local record store and buy it.
They were quite a well-established band when you parachuted in then.
Oh, well, Ronnie Montrose was well-established.
Yeah.
Obviously I wasn't, but he was the focal point of the band, basically, at that point. It was the Ronnie Montrose band.
Yeah.
Gamma was the Ronnie Montrose band.
So, so label deals, all that.
Yeah, we got signed to Elektra.
Yeah.
Major label. We did, I don't know, 1, 2, 3 album. problems for them, and then we split up, and I started playing around by myself,
yeah,
my own band, and so then I got a call from
Robin Trower. Basically, you're jumping from clubs in Glasgow around Paisley. We're going to talk about Paisley because you're back here just now, one of the clubs here. But you went from doing these clubs, some session work in London,
yeah,
to stadium gigs.
Yeah.
In one jump.
Yeah. A wee bit scary at the time. Actually, I didn't like the stadium gigs. I didn't enjoy those.
No.
There's no, you can't get...
There's no rapport.
You can't get close to the audience.
Yeah.
And for me, what I do is get close to the audience.
Nice.
Or try.
Yeah.
So, but when they're a quarter of a mile away,
yeah,
it's kind of difficult.
Yeah. And, of course, you've been dealing with the whole... It was San Francisco, you were... So that's at the end of the hippie era,
yeah,
and everything, eh?
Yeah. I mean, if I'd got there 10 years... I've always thought if I'd got to San Francisco 10 years before I did, I'd be a multi-millionaire by now.
Well, and you might have played Woodstock and all the other,
yeah,
things at Santana and all those guys.
That's
did,
right.
Did do.
Yeah.
Wonderful. So did you ever open for Santana? There you go.
A lot, because we managed... Bill managed Carlos as well, so... Both bands were out on the road. Obviously, we would open, but
yeah.
That was fine. We're playing 20,000 people every night.
Exactly.
And we got a good laugh, you know, with those guys.
I could just
very fond
I could
of
only sometime. Imagine what that lifestyle was like.
Well, it was nuts. Basically,
crazy.
It was just absolutely crazy.
Yeah.
It's
like the movie. It's like the movie Almost Famous.
Everybody used to think that, or still think probably, that the music business at that level. It's a glamorous lifestyle.
Yeah.
It's not.
Yeah.
It's far from being glamorous. It's a lonely lifestyle.
Long,
actually.
Long, hard.
Yeah, you're constantly,
bus
constantly
trips,
traveling,
travel,
and
yeah,
you know the only people you meet are the four guys in the van with you.
Yeah.
Unless you're talking to fans afterwards.
Yeah.
That's the only connection you've had with the outside world, because
yeah,
you're like blinkered.
Yeah.
You know.
And there's management and agencies and publicists and all the other,
yeah,
stuff in the way.
I mean, I took nothing to do with it. I just showed up and played the gigs, you know.
Okay, so we're on the trail, we're up and about, running around doing these stadium gigs and top club gigs. Are you still at this point, are you doing session work in LA and
not
San
since
Francisco?
I came back here, no. The actual fact, not the last few years I was over there, that whole thing had dried up.
Uh-huh.
The music business in America, probably like here, has just changed drastically.
Yeah.
In America, what hurt most of all, I think, with record sales was that you couldn't get on the radio. It didn't matter who you were.
Mm-hmm.
You could not get new music on the radio in America.
Mm-hmm.
Record stores all closed,
yeah,
down.
Then Napster came in, and the rest is past history.
Oh, yeah, I mean, the music business, as I know it,
yeah,
was pretty much dead.
Yeah. Well, we'll talk about how you're reinventing yourself here in Scotland as well. Before we do that, I just can't help but notice the Robin Trower cover.
Oh, that's the Fillmore in San Francisco.
Wow.
It's the Fillmore West, yeah.
Yeah. So... How you toured with Robin as well?
Oh,
how many albums did you do with Robin Trower?
Oh, about 10 maybe.
I know you're the voice of those albums.
Well,
they
yeah,
were so
I mean,
big in the 70s.
Jimmy was before me.
Yeah.
Jimmy Drew.
Jimmy
Drew. Who, in my opinion, is the best singer ever to come out of this country.
Yeah.
Many other people would agree with that.
Yeah.
I'm sure. But he was the original singer in Montrose, and yeah, Jimmy got ill in 1980, I believe. And Robin was working with Jack Bruce at that point.
Right.
And then he had Dave Brown as the bass player sing on an album, and they did some tours. And Dave wasn't happy as a singer.
Yeah.
Great bass player, plays with Clapton.
Yeah.
Played with Clapton and
nice.
Tom Jones.
Yeah.
I think he's still with Tom Jones. If Tom Jones is still playing, I hear
yeah.
stories that he's not, but I don't know. So in 1986, I got a call from Robin saying, would you be interested in singing on my next album?
Yeah.
I'd heard another tape. Robin was friendly with someone I knew in California who's a producer. And he played some of the stuff that I was on to Robin.
Right.
Consequently, I got a call, and the first term I had with Robin was probably 1986 to 91 maybe.
Yeah.
And then he took a break, and then he came back with somebody else. And then I got another call a few years later, and I was there for another 10 years or something. There was a lot of records. I don't know exactly how many, but it was about 10.
Amazing. And really the heart of a lot of people's record collections at that time. Because I would go in, there'd be records out into the middle of the room in everybody's flats. You'd go to a party, you would skip through the records to see.
Yeah, right.
Wasn't a pile. There wasn't a pile that you wouldn't find four or five Robin Trower albums.
Right.
And you'd have been on those albums as well.
Yeah.
So, there we are. We're talking about that career. We're talking about you as a rock singer. How strong is the blues an influence on all of that?
The blues have been, regardless of what I'm saying,
right,
the blues are never far away.
Right.
I mean, I've sung years ago here in Glasgow. I sang in a big band with a guy called Bill Fanning.
Right.
And all these guys from the Scottish National Orchestra who
right.
were jazz freaks on the side.
Yeah.
And I sang with that in the Communist Club down by the Clyde side.
That's a gig I want to go to.
Yeah.
Let's reenact that gig.
It was kind of different. but, you know, these guys, they were all incredible musicians who were playing Sinatra stuff.
Right.
On the side.
Yeah.
And when Bill brought me in, they went from Sinatra to Stevie Wonder.
Nice.
So we were doing stuff like Sir Duke, you know.
Yeah.
Can you imagine that with
wow.
a huge band? It was incredible.
Wow.
I loved every second of it.
Yeah.
What
year is this, Davey, if you don't mind?
That would be 76.
Yeah, right, so this is before you went to States,
yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. I mean, at Paisley here, I was in I had a band called Findlegask.
Uh-huh.
Which was highly successful here around the west of Scotland. So kind of, when we're trying to be the band, we're trying to be Bob Dylan's the band.
Yeah. Oh, all right. Yeah. Okay.
That's what we're
high
trying
aspiration.
To
aim at. Yeah, it's Scottish equivalent.
So we went to London and recorded some stuff with a guy called Hugh Murphy. It was actually some of the best moments of my life. Was played in that band.
Nice.
Yeah, we were young and crazy.
Anything was possible, eh?
We thought we were going to be superstars.
Yeah.
You know, and of course.
Well, I'm looking at these posters, and it'd be hard to argue that you weren't up there with some of the greats. I mean, Greg Allman is three down the bill from Gamma and that one there.
Did a whole bunch of shows with the Allman Brothers and I was with Trower, and they were really good people.
Aye.
No rock star crap.
Yeah.
You know, I've never had any time for rock stars.
Yeah.
I found rock stars to be soulless, not very talented people who cover that up by bullshit.
Another interview. I might go into more depth than that one, but we'll just let that one slide over.
Okay, I'll stop the swearing.
So there you are, out and about with this huge career. What was the motivation to come home?
Well, it's actually two things, really. My wife and I have 30 years divorced.
Uh-huh.
Sadly, it's still a sad part of my life, actually, that.
Yeah.
And the state of the music business.
Aye.
And we got divorced, and I'm still touring with Robin and
doing
all that stuff.
Well, you can, yeah.
But then the music business changed, as we were talking about earlier.
Yeah.
We couldn't get on the radio.
Yeah.
There was no record stores anymore. Yeah. You know, the business was just, poof, you know. And then I thought, I've got some health issues. I've got diabetes, which is a royal pain in the backside for
yeah.
anybody who's got it.
Yeah, well, I have friends with it as well. My mother suffered as well.
Nasty,
yeah.
nasty disease. So the medical bills in America are astronomical.
Yeah, yeah.
And I'm sitting here going, I'm having to go to the doctor, you know,
yeah.
a couple of times a month.
Yeah.
And it was hundreds.
Yeah.
On top of the insurance policies.
Yeah, yeah. yeah.
Hundreds, the copays were
yeah.
astronomical. So I'm saying to myself, well, the music business is dying here.
Yeah.
You're paying a fortune for healthcare. You can
yeah.
go home.
Yeah.
And just call it a day.
Right.
You know, 50
yeah.
odd years of, you know,
yeah.
playing rock and roll all over the damn world. So
right.
you've done all right, you know.
Right.
You've done what you set out to do kind of thing. So why not go home? So I thought about that, and I thought about that for about 5 years probably.
Uh-huh.
And then decided, okay, I'm going home. So I sold my house. Moved back here in 2018.
Just in time for COVID.
Yeah, exactly. In actual fact, when I think about it, I left California.
Probably
the best time
yeah.
to do it was then.
Yeah.
Because the music business after COVID was non-existent.
Yeah, yeah.
Like it was here.
Well, it's rebuilding, let's
yeah,
say.
Yeah, yeah. I hope.
Who knows in what direction, but it is rebuilding.
Let's hope so.
Yeah.
So
you landed and you got itchy feet again. Is that what
I came home
you
with the intention of retiring.
Yeah.
That was the, okay, go home, retire. Now, I've been a musician all my life, so I should have known better.
yeah.
Retirement and musician.
It's not really an option.
No, it doesn't get there, you know.
yeah.
It doesn't do that.
Yeah.
So after about a year, and then the phone would go, and you know, people admired the new musicians here. Would go,
yeah.
Why aren't they playing, Dave? You know,
you should be
playing. So then I thought about it. Then COVID hit.
Yeah.
So there goes 2 years.
Yeah.
So about a year ago, I started seriously thinking about it. And we started out with five guys, one of which is Michael Grant.
Yeah. He's kind of like your musical partner. He's like your musical partner in this new enterprise, isn't
yes.
he?
Yes. Yeah, Mike is a great guy.
Yeah.
I don't call him Mikey, I call him Michael.
Yeah.
I get that's a respect thing, basically, for me. But anyway,
yeah.
The same with the rest of the guys that eventually showed up to play
yeah.
in this thing.
Yeah.
Great players, great guys.
Yeah.
No drunks,
yeah.
no druggies.
Yeah.
No rock star arseholes.
Yeah.
None of that stuff.
Yeah.
You know, just regular people who want to play
and are ready to play great music.
Yeah.
yeah.
So,
and they'll all have stories of their own that they're bringing to this party as well, I would imagine.
Oh, sure, yeah. I mean, basically what we're playing is a bunch of my songs,
yeah.
from the two solo albums that I've done over the years.
Yeah, one of which is on a limited release at the moment as well, around the radio
the
station.
Mississippi Nights,
yeah.
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 yeah. yeah.
And I did another one after that as well.
Yeah, which is to be, might well be released when you start touring
yes.
and gigging.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. We'll re-release it probably.
Yeah. Cool.
So, we're playing that, some blues classics that we've rearranged.
Yeah.
The thought of copying somebody's stuff note for note just appalls me.
Aye.
So, we changed the arrangements. And
yeah.
changed the feel.
Yeah.
Because it's really all about the feel.
Yeah. It's all about the band, it would seem, at the moment
it
as
is.
Well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I can't wait.
You're deep into the rehearsal process. You are actually, you've booked a return gig.
Yes. Funny enough, the last time I played in Paisley.
Yeah.
I'd been on an American tour with Gallon. And we come back for a holiday. A couple of my pals say, "Well, you're here, why don't we do a little gig?" And I've been playing the bungalow,
which
at that time was was on the Renfrew Road.
Right.
It's now in downtown Paisley, basically.
Yeah.
I thought, well, a great place to play after 42 years would be the Bungalow.
Yeah, yeah.
And I know the guy who owns it, Tommy McRory, who's a great guy. So I talked to Tommy, goes, oh, let's do it.
Yeah.
So we've got a gig there, our first gig. First gig in 42 years in Paisley. I'm actually looking forward.
What date's the gig?
That's the November 24th, I believe.
November 24th at the Bungalow in Paisley, the Davey Pattison. It's just, you're calling yourself the Davey Pattison Band.
Davey Pattison Blues Band.
Davey Pattison Blues Band, homecoming gig after 42 years in Paisley. And you will have the CDs, and you have a bit, and the interest is starting to grow around about the whole thing. Yeah, yeah.
I mean, there's a story there, there's a nice story there.
It's a lovely story, and yeah. it's a delight to be here to recount it with you in some ways as well, Davey, and thank you for inviting me into your home to do that. Also, your goals. I mean, I know that you're not going to be wanting to push it out there like the young man that you once were.
No, I mean, I'm not expecting to play Hampden Park.
No.
You know, I'd really rather not play pubs.
Yeah.
To be honest with you. I started out in pubs, and I know how.
I don't mind if I don't do another pub gig again,
I mean, I'll do nightclubs.
Yeah.
And I'd like to play the festivals.
Yeah. And dedicated blues clubs and some blues festivals.
Yeah, proper venues as opposed to, the wee pub down the road there. You know?
Yeah, yeah.
I've been there, done that.
Very cool. Well, anything we can do, I'm sure, just all you have to do is ask. And I can't wait. I think it's... And I know Mikey, I know the quality of the musicians that are involved. Yeah. I'm yet to hear the whole thing. So I'm so looking forward to that.
It's very cool.
Yeah. And I mean, if you're saying that, it's very cool.
I'm more than pleased with the guys I've got now.
Okay. So 22nd, get yourselves along. Just keep your eye on these pages. I'll have the event page up there, how you can get tickets. It's a ridiculous £10 ticket price as well, Davey.
Well, I wanted to make sure that I could meet some new people.
Aye. Well, that's
what but get the older people in as well. So, I want to see old and new friends.
Yeah, yeah.
You know.
So that's at the Bungalow. The Bungalow is in Paisley. Please do get in touch. Get in touch with Davey. Get in touch with the band. Like their Facebook. That's a way of doing all sorts of things. The album is up on Spotify, and you can follow on Spotify. Tell your friends, let your friends know that it's all going down. We've got 2023 in front of us.
Hope to see many of you.
Yeah. Thanks again, Davey.
Cheers, mate.